various comments at the end of the first talk. Some were about Rilke, and they're not relevant here, but there were in particular comments about the proof that the square root of 2 and the square root of 5 were irrational. So I want to make a couple of additional remarks. Someone suggested, for example, that the proof of the square root, that the square root of 2 was irrational, which I, a proof that I made by showing that if the square root of 2 were the quotient of two integers, then they'd both have to be even, which was a contradiction because I could assume they were in lowest possible terms. Now, I forgot, there was something else I wanted to put up. Excuse me, I just wanted to remind you once again of some dates. I put that up just to remind us that we're in the, didn't turn out very well. So it's not very good. I just wanted to remind you of the dates, the pertinent dates, and that's not clear. That should be, say, that Aristotle flourished around, so Aristotle flourished around 340, just to put Aristotle to indicate that he was a little bit after Eudoxus, a little bit after Plato, but a little before Euclid, but long after Pythagoras. Because the first quote here is from Aristotle, and this indicates that whatever my proof was, it wasn't too much of an anachronism in the sense that it appears, and I think this is a familiar quote, it appears in a discussion of Aristotle on logic. Now, Aristotle wasn't interested so much in the mathematical proof or in the rationality or irrationality of square root of 2. At this point, he was more interested in the nature of the proof by reductio ad absurdum. But in any case, the proof that I gave last time is no more anachronistic than Aristotle. It's not, however, clear what Pythagoras might have done. And it's been suggested for various reasons that the first proof given, which would have been the proof, say, by Pythagoras or someone, some of his contemporaries, was not algebraic but geometric. And in fact, someone came up after the lecture and presented me with the paper folding proof, which is basically the geometric proof. Now, the reason that various historians have, one of the reasons, and I don't know whether they're good reasons, have suggested that the original proof might be different than the one I suggested and perhaps even more complex, is the dialogue of Plato, or at least the first few lines of that, of a dialogue of Plato. The dialogue of Plato is not about mathematics, it's about wisdom or knowledge, which are presumably quite different than mathematics. But, and I've abridged the first few lines. You see, it's rather curious. It starts off in a rather contemporary way. Socrates and Theodorus, who is a mathematician, are discussing the promising youth, as some people sometimes do now when they meet. And even the second remark of Theodorus has a rather contemporary air. He sounds a little, questions of sexual orientation aside, as though he has an anxious administration breathing down his neck. But what then the conversation shifts to a pupil of Theodorus, who did go on to become a mathematician, Theaetetus. And what Theaetetus observes is that Theodorus has basically given the proof that I gave last time for the irrationality of the square root of 5, for the square root of 3, the square root of 5, the square root of 7, and with 4, 9, and 16 excluded. He's done that up until 17. So all the numbers that aren't, he's shown that all the numbers up to 17, except those numbers that are squares, like 4, 9, and 16, do have irrational square roots. And then, as Theaetetus says, for some reason or other, he stopped. Now, I just observed that the reason isn't given. He may have stopped because he was hungry. He may have stopped because he wanted to leave something for his students to do. And in fact, Theaetetus apparently did much more. He seems to be a known mathematician. But I think largely on the basis of this particular discussion, there have been claims by various historians of mathematics that a harder, more a proof should have, Theaetetus must have found a proof that varied considerably from case to case, and the geometric proof is one such proof. Anyhow, that was just an observation in relation to what was said after the lecture. Today, our first task is, in fact, no longer the irrationality of the numbers that are generated by the Pythagorean theorem, but the Pythagorean theorem itself. And as I recall, the Pythagorean theorem says that the area of the big square, large square, which is the square and hypotenuse, is equal to the sum of the two smaller areas, areas of the two So that's what we have to try to show. But before we do that, there are a couple of further quotes that I want to give, just to put some things in context. Because the irrationality, or the what I was going to say is that the importance of the discovery of the irrationality of the square root of 2 and of the crisis it caused in Greek mathematics is germane to the story I want to relate only insofar as we want to arrive at some understanding of the contemporary problems posed by irrationality, and indeed by irrationality of a special kind, by algebraic irrationality, a notion that it will take us some time to reach. Nonetheless, I thought I would give just two fairly brief quotations from Neugebauer, one from Neugebauer and one from Heath, a well-known historian of Greek mathematics, that may not be out of place, and especially as I observed the last time, because Eudoxus is not a name that's well-known to most mathematicians. And I think you can read for yourself as I'm talking that from Neugebauer, and there's one thing I want to observe in what Neugebauer says, and that is that the geometrical treatment, a treatment which I will follow quite a while, was the result of the Greeks, apparently the result of the Greeks' geometrical treatment of number, which was somewhat of an historical accident. And apparently, according to Neugebauer, peculiar to the Greeks, as other mathematicians of antiquity, without the Greeks' respect for logic, proceeded differently. And as you will see, the geometrical treatment is much less straightforward than an algebraic treatment, which will come later, so that it may be that the historical approach obscures as much as it enlightens. All right, so what does, let me see, I have a pencil, as someone suggested, and let me use it. So he observes that the corollary that the diagonal of the square could not be measured by its side, so that they're incommensurable. So in a certain sense, if the side was 1, then or that the ratio of the length of the hypotenuse to the length of the side of a right angle triangle, both of whose short sides are of equal length, is square root of 2, and that is not an irrational number. It was caused serious discussion about the relation between geometrical and arithmetical proof. The reaction of the mathematicians led to two major steps. First of all, the strictly axiomatic procedure, and secondly, it had become clear that one should consider the geometric objects as the given entities, and the cases of integer ratios appeared as a special case of only secondary interest. That's a peculiar fact, and there's nothing, so to speak, intrinsically necessary about it. And let me now then cite, also just read a little bit from Heath, that you can, tells us that this book 5, I'll describe a little later the content of the 13 books of Euclid, just so that we're aware of what the content is, but we will not, in fact, go beyond book 4 here. So, at least not at first. And it's Eudoxus who apparently was the discoverer of the general theory of proportions. Eudoxus did other things as well, but that's what's pertinent for us here. Now, the essence of the new theory was that it was applicable to incommensurable as well as commensurable quantities, so if you like, to irrational as well as rational quantities. And its importance cannot be overrated, for it enabled geometry to go forward again after it received the blow which paralyzed it for the time. This was the discovery of irrational at a time when geometry still depended on the Pythagorean theorem of proportion. Well, that is the numerical theory, which was, of course, applicable only to commensurables. Now, I just add then that this theory of eudoxus, just to indicate to non-mathematicians its importance, was important until, and played a role down into the, and even today, but in particular down into the 19th century when the nation, when the notion of number was given what its contemporary meaning by mathematicians such as Dedekind and Weierstrass. So it was obviously an important discovery and an incidental consequence, if you like, of discovery of the irrationality of the square root of 2. All right. So now we come to the proof of the Pythagorean theorem. And let me remind you how it goes. I tried a little trick, but I don't know if it works. There it is. So what do we want to prove? We want to prove that the area of the large square is equal to the sum of the area of those two squares. And we're going to use triangles. We're going to use triangles as indicated here. But there's something to be explained about those triangles. And actually, I'll come back to this later, there's something to be explained because those triangles are a trap into which Euclid fell. Turns out that this particular proof, as Deleen pointed out to me, is not, my colleague Deleen, is not so solid, not so well-founded as it might be. That Euclid has avoided Scylla, but fallen into Charybdis, as we will see. So, as I say, what we are going to do, we are going to show that the area, the larger square is an area, and it is the sum of two areas, namely the area of this piece and of this piece, which are obtained simply by going to this vertex and drawing from that vertex a line perpendicular to the hypotenuse and extending it all the way down to the bottom. So we have these two rectangles, and the proof proceeds by showing that the area of this rectangle is equal to the area of this square, that the area of this rectangle is equal to the area of that square. Now, there's clearly a certain symmetry, and it will suffice to prove that the area of this rectangle is equal to the area of that square. And let's set about that. I begin with something that is anachronistic, but I just want to remind you of it. You'll be familiar with it from high school, and I want to remind you of it anyhow. That's the formula for an area of the triangle, which is anachronistic because, of course, for Euclid, an area is an area and a number is a number, and they're not the same things. We should speak rather in Euclid's terms of the area of a triangle, or twice the area of a triangle being equal to the area of a parallelogram. But in any case, the formula that which I recall, and which you may recall from high school, is the area of a triangle is 1/2 the base times the height. So this is a triangle, this is its base, and this is its height. So the height, we draw a line perpendicular to the base through the third vertex. And to see that the area is 1/2 the base times the height, we do the following. We take that triangle, and we take a congruent triangle, and we turn it around and put it here so that we obtain a rectangle. And this, so that we obtain, in fact, a parallelogram. This side is parallel to this. That side is parallel to that. I mark it again. And then we just, if you like, cut this little triangle off and put it here. And we see that this area, which is certainly twice the area of the triangle, has become equal to the area of a rectangle, the same base as the triangle, and the same height. And one persuaded, I suppose, that the area of the rectangle is equal to the base times the height. Now, you may or may not be persuaded by that, but it's fairly persuasive. Now, there is a difficulty which we make it, shall come back later, which is not a difficulty for Euclid, but maybe a difficulty for you, namely that if I have a triangle, there are three possible sides, and therefore I have three choices of bases. I could use that as my base, as I did, or I could use that as my base, and then the height would be something coming out here, down to there, or I could use this as my base, and then I have a third height. So I, in fact, have three formulas for the area of a triangle, and unless I take as given that the area has a meaning, I'm in trouble. Now, Euclid took as given that the area has a meaning, and so that's it. So let's come back to that question. But in a certain sense, this difficulty vitiates Euclid's proof. But let me run through it anyhow. It is certainly an elegant proof. So on the basis of that, on the assumption, basically, that areas have meaning. And I say this is presumably this Greek insistence on geometry. For the Greeks, an area was an area and it had meaning. So we have here, we want to show that this area is equal to that area, two squares. Now what we do is we replace them by two triangles. I tried to put a little color into it, but it didn't work out too well. But let me just point out, in regard to these two triangles, that this side of the one is equal to this side of the other, because I drew a square there. That this side of the one, so of this one, is equal to this side of the other, because that's a square. So I have these triangles and two sides. They have two sides that are of equal length, one with the other. And in addition, one triangle has this as an angle. The other triangle has that as an angle. But these two are right angles, and these are in common. So this angle is the same as this angle. And if you recall the theory of congruent triangles, if I have two triangles, and if two sides are adjacent to an angle in each, the angles are the same and the sides have the same length, then the triangles are congruent. So those triangles are congruent as they look. And that means they have the same area. Now, let's just think a little bit about this formula. Let's think about the base, and let's think about the height. And let's choose the bases and the heights carefully. For this triangle, this first triangle, we choose this to be the base, and then this is the height, because this is the side parallel to the base, and that's where the third vertex is. It's on this side. So, according to that formula, the area of this first triangle is just one half the area of this rectangle. Now, if the area of the second triangle, which is the same as the area of the first because they're congruent, happens to be equal to one half the area of that square, then we're in business. And so we choose what I observe as a different base, namely this, as the base of the triangle. It's not a corresponding side. It doesn't correspond to that side. This is the base, and then this is the line parallel to the base through the other vertex. So the height is that side of the square. So the base is one side of the square. The height is given by the other side of the square, and therefore the triangle, that second triangle, has area equal to one half the square. So one half the square is one half this rectangle, and therefore they're equal. And that's the proof, and it's a good proof, and it's persuasive. There's just this little trick involved. You choose one base for one triangle, and then for the congruent triangle, you choose a base on a different side. Nonetheless, that is Euclid's proof. And a number of people have commented on it. Nietzsche referred to it as stelzbeinig, hinterlistig, so stilted and sly. And as you see, he was perhaps not far off the mark. And Aldous Huxley, in a short story about thwarted mathematical genius, gives what he says might be and what proof that I'll give in a minute, the original proof of Pythagoras. And there are some historians of mathematics who will agree with them. Now, Alex, you can read that if you like. It's actually quite a clear, if one wants to describe a mathematical proof in prose, that's quite a clear description. I'll give it with figures later. Now, this is a story called Young Archimedes about thwarted mathematical genius. The next proof, if you read our, in Aldous Huxley's story, is discovered independently as on his own by a child of seven who doesn't survive, unfortunately, for mathematics, but is commits suicide not long afterwards for other reasons that aren't pertinent here. So what is the proof that Aldous Huxley is describing here? It's a little bit different, but it's also based on area. But he does, this is certainly an old proof, but here it is. And as I said, it has been suggested not alone by Aldous Huxley, but by some historians that it perhaps was the Pythagorean proof. We're interested in this. This is our triangle. This is our right angle triangle. This one. And we just put four together, all the same. So everything is put inside this larger square. And in the middle, we have what is the square and the hypotenuse. And we want to show that it's equal to the sum of the squares on the other two sides. Well, all we have to do is take that big square and decompose it differently. And that's what we do. So we take these four right angle triangles and we put them together, two by two. If I overlaid it, you would see it. But we leave this one where it is. We turn this one around and put it right here in order, if I have things right to obtain this rectangle. Now, we leave this one where it is, and we turn this one around and put it, we better do more than that. We have to move this one down and then, what we have to do is turn this one around and put it here, and then we better turn it on its side as well. But the result is that we end up with this piece. And what you see is that this then, since we took those four right angle triangles and just laid them in like that. What is left over is the square on one of the sides adjacent to the right angle, plus the square on the other side adjacent to the right angle. So we have these four triangles, the area of the big square is given. We have inside the right angle triangle four times. And what's left over then, the area left over, is on the one hand the area of the square and hypotenuse. On the other hand, it's the sum of the squares on the other two sides. So what's left over must be equal. So arguing from areas. So that's a second possible proof. And it's a very appealing proof geometrically, I think. But most historians feel that it is not the Greek proof. It looks like a Chinese proof. And Heath presents, there are many, many proofs, but Heath presents a proof that he suggests could very well be the kind of proof that Pythagoras would have liked, but that Euclid had to avoid for reasons I'll explain in just a minute. The difficulty of this particular proof from Euclid's point of view was that it has to use the theory of similar triangles, as I'll explain. And the theory of similar triangles is something that Euclid doesn't have. Pythagorean theorem is proved in book one. Theory of similar triangles Euclid doesn't have until book six, so that it's just not available to him. And in a certain sense, it was an expository tour de force on the part of Euclid to give another proof, a proof which was in some sense like this, but avoided the use of similar triangles. Now, let me explain the proof. Let me recall what it means to be similar. Triangles are similar. For example, geometrically, it's somehow clear. Intuitively, it's clear. We have the large triangle here, ABC. It looks, in every respect, apart from orientation, like the triangle ABD, except that it's bigger. That means that corresponding sides, for example, the side AD on the small triangle corresponds to the side AB on the big triangle, and the ratio of their lengths is the same. It's independent. If we take corresponding sides, the ratio is always the same. For example, the ratio between AD and AB, which are corresponding sides, is the same as the ratio of the hypotenuse. So the hypotenuse of the smaller circle is this, it's AB. The hypotenuse of the smaller triangle is AB. The hypotenuse of the larger triangle is AC. So we have those two ratios that are the same. And as I said, this is perfectly legitimate, provided one has established the notion of similar triangles and whence triangles are similar. These triangles are similar. One has to look at the angles. They're similar because one can establish these two angles are right angles, as is this one. If we look at this triangle and this triangle, they have that angle in common, and then using the fact that the sum of the angles in a triangle is 180 degrees, one establishes that this angle is equal to that. So there's a little work to do to show that they're similar, but it's easy enough to do on the basis of what one already knows from Euclid. And the same argument applied to the other triangle, in which we take now DC, this side, compare it to BC. So we have this triangle. We want to compare it similar to the large one. So DC is one of the sides adjacent to the right angle, and it corresponds to this side. BC is the hypotenuse of this triangle, and we compare it to the hypotenuse of the big large triangle, and these ratios are the same. That's what it means to be similar. So what this means, and it's better to write it this way in some sense, that AD times AC is equal to AB squared. If you like, from our point of view, we just bring the AC up there and the AB up there. We do the same thing here, DC, bring the AC up, equal to BC squared, and then we add. We get AB squared, which is the square on this, plus the square on this, which is BC squared, is equal to AD times AC plus DC times AC. So these are two rectangles, if you like, but doing the algebra in our way, we just take AD plus DC, that's AC, and we get AC squared. So this is a proof that Euclid avoided, and it's a proof which would be much easier if, for example, one knew that all those sides were commensurable and would be legitimate to the Pythagoreans. But that proof he had to avoid, as I said, because he doesn't talk about commensurable triangles or similar triangles until chapter 6, after he talks about proportions. That's clear that similar triangles are based on the notion of proportions. Now, Eudoxes, this book 5 is rather, in some sense, a rather simple book, but it's a rather elegant book. And I want to observe, just for fun of it, that one aspect of the art of mathematics is the formulation of good definitions. It's a peculiar art, and I think in the second half of the 20th century, there was one master of this, namely Grothendieck, a name that won't be familiar to many of you, but he was rather an exceptional mathematician. And his definitions were often breathtaking, namely, they transform what had previously been arcane, difficult theory, to mention something that would be known to mathematicians, namely complex multiplication, into something self-evident. It's really very striking. And what appears, at least on the first reading of Book 5 of the Elements on Euclid on Proportions, is that Eudoxes had this same ability. And the proof of the proposition 6.1, which is the first proposition in the following book, is a statement that's accessible to everyone. And it's an example, for me, it was a particularly striking, particularly simple example of what one can do with a good definition. You want to see what a good definition is in mathematics and how you can use it to dispense with any proof, really. You can look at proposition 6.1, which asserts that triangles and parallelograms, which are under the same height, are to one another as their basis. And it's not so important to understand what that says. I just insist that this aspect of mathematics can be seen at a very early stage, and quite elegant there. Now, as I said, and as Heath in particular argues, this is something I get from Heath, that the proof of the Pythagorean theorem in Euclid's form appears to be Euclid's response to an expository challenge, namely the necessity of doing without similar triangles. So the proof that I, first proof that I gave is similar to this in some ways, but no similar triangles appear. So he found a new proof, not somewhat similar to the first proof, but in his eyes, without the flaw. But of course, there was a flaw, the flaw, and the flaw that I mentioned that was discovered, or that people began to think of as a flaw much later. And it was, as far as I know, it was only in the exactly 100 years ago that Hilbert addressed the problem of showing that an area which for him was not something given but a number was a number well defined. And the first thing he has to do in order to establish that a number is well defined is prove that the area is well defined, is prove this fact that although four triangle, one half the base times the height, appears to give three numbers, those numbers are all the same. So, all right, so I think we're almost finished. We're finished, in some sense, with the Pythagorean theorem. And we can go on as this next step towards the pentagon. We can go on, and I just mentioned as an aside, let's go start with four regular solids. Now, the cube is a regular solid with which everyone is familiar. It has four, it has eight sides, they're all squares. These squares are all of the same size. And in this picture, which I borrowed from Mathematica, three of those, how many sides did I say it had? Four, I probably said six, it has six. So there are six of which you see three, and the other three are behind, all of the same size. A simpler regular solid is the tetrahedron, which does have four sides, all of which are triangles, and of which you see three. The tetrahedron is kind of a pyramid, except that it's on a triangular base. And so there's a triangular base under all that. And back here, there's another side, which is again a triangle. So this is a solid. The sides of that solid are all triangles. They're all equilateral triangles in the sense that they are triangles all of whose sides are the same length, therefore all of whose angles are the same, and therefore all of whose angles are 60 degrees, I guess. And it's well known. Well, I'll give you the other. I'll give you two more regular solids, just so we have them. I'll come back to them in a minute. It's well known that Plato, the reasons that weren't so bad in some sense, identified these four solids with the four elements. And this has nothing to do with my talk, clearly. But I just mentioned that the more acute the angles were, the lighter the element was. For example, the tetrahedron was identified with fire. And the cube, which, as we'll see, has the most obtuse angles, is identified with the earth. And then he describes two more regular solids, one of which is an octahedron. An octahedron has, as its name strongly suggests, eight sides. So it has, if you think of it, it's made up of two pieces. There's an upper pyramid and a lower pyramid. we see, I guess, three of the sides of the upper pyramid, and there's one behind, and one side of the lower pyramid. And I hope this is clear on the picture. Blame Stephen Wolfram and his associates if it isn't, that those triangles are all equilateral in the sense that the three sides of any given triangle are all of the same length, and all triangles have the same length. And of course, there are four triangles around any vertex. And since this also has fairly acute angles, it gets to be air. Then the icosahedron, which is harder to see, it has 20 sides, of which you see easily five on one side, and then there must be five on the other behind, exactly the same, and then a belt of 10, if you like, around the middle, which you must see 1, 2, 3. So you'd have one, two, three, and then another one here and another one here to make up 10. And then you'd have something exactly the same at the back, and you just fit them together right. Turn it a little, and you fit them together so they meshed, and that would give you something completely symmetric in all respects and with 20 sides. And that is water. Now, these are the four on which Plato insists the most, and he likes them quite a bit. And in particular, he thinks of them as being made up not of squares, as in the case of the square, as we would, but made up of right angle triangles. But for this is for him the basic right angle triangle, one for which the two sides adjacent to the right angle are equal. And this equilateral triangle, he thinks of as being made up of two right angle triangles. Not so important, but you notice that this has sides which are in the ratio square root of 3, this one, to 2, which is this, to 1, which is that. This is one. This length is 1/2 this, and the ratio between this length and this is the square root of 3. And as you can see, that it works out, the square root of 3 squared plus 1 is 2 squared. So these are pretty simple. Now, there is, and I observed just in passing, when I come down to it, that we'll go on, that those are the square and those are the triangle, and of course we can inscribe the square, the triangle is easy, also the square, in a circle. Now, the one solid, the one regular solid for which Plato doesn't find a very convincing place and hardly mentions at all, is one that's of more interest to us, the dodecahedron, which has 12 sides. And you can think of it, you can see the 12, namely, there's this pentagonal side, which is right there in the middle. There's another one behind it. And then around it, there's a belt of 5. And then there's a similar belt of 5. And then you get to the back one. And this is, of course, the regular solid in which we're most interested because we're interested in the pentagon, the regular pentagon. So we will soon leave for a long time, maybe forever, leave the dodecahedron behind us and concentrate on this five-sided figure and see what we can say about it. I just wanted to indicate that it had a connection with the regular solids. And I observe this again has nothing whatsoever to do with the talk, that I understand, and I'm probably wrong, but I didn't look very far in the literature, and I looked in some very old literature, that both the pentagon and the dodecahedron were relatively rare as artistic motifs. And they seem to have been favored by the Celts. And that's an example that I give you of what appears to be a weight. maybe it would have had something inside to make it made of bronze, I think. But it would, you could hold it in the palm of your hand, but it's used as a weight. And something else similar, that shows you the unfolding of the surface. That's a die. That's a die made of stone, and all these funny symbols on the faces, of which there are, as I said, 12, can be interpreted apparently as numbers. You can see, though, you can see there are 12 regular pentagons, and if I fold it up just right, I'll end up with that solid dodecahedron that I described before, and you could gamble with it if you were so inclined. It's even suggested, and I don't suppose that this would be the kind of myth that I mentioned, that Pythagoras, who spent some time, this was discovered in northern Italy, and it's been suggested that Pythagoras, who spent some time in Italy, may have come in contact with the Celts through the Etruscans, and that spent some time in southern Italy, but this was northern Italy, but it's not such a big country after all. And he may have had some contact with the Celts, but this is not, I guess, to be taken very seriously. I observe that apparently this dodecahedron seems to occur approximately in nature in its form of crystals of iron pyrites. It can occur exactly because of the nature of crystallographic laws, but does occur approximately, and the Celts, since they like to make weapons among other things, were certainly interested in iron and smelting it, and could smelt it. And Hermann Weyl's book, it's mentioned that there is a marine creature called a radiolarian, and that they actually have this symmetry. They have actually the dodecahedral symmetry, but they're minute marine creatures, and I don't suppose the Celts actually came in contact with them. All right, so that's aside. Now we want to start work on the pentagon. We want to see if we can't construct it geometrically. That's our next task, which will take us through part of the rest of this hour and into the next hour. So there it is. We can assume it can be inscribed in a circle. That will follow. But we don't know it exists at this moment. We just think it exists. So there it is. We want to construct it. And let's look at it for a minute or two and think about it. Sitting in it is a triangle built in the obvious way. This triangle has a special property that I want to, that we have to think about. I'll tell you something, and I'm actually going to prove it, but I'll just tell it to you for now. Namely, if I have a chord like this in a circle, and if I take any point here and draw the angle, so draw these two lines, one line to this end of the chord, other line to that end of the chord, then this angle doesn't depend upon the point I chose. Let's just see what this means over here. Well, one possibility is to choose these two lines. This is a point on the circle, one of the vertices of the pentagon, and I get this angle. I could choose any vertex of the pentagon, so I could choose this one and take these two lines and get this angle, or this one and get this angle. So according to this theorem, which we have still to convince ourselves, these three angles are all equal. But look at it again. Let's think about this angle. So we have this triangle. And just because of the rotational symmetry, if you like, of this pentagon, we could rotate this around. Just take this, move it around 1/5 of the way, and we end up with this triangle. So that means that this angle is the same as this angle, because that's where we end up. Right? But this angle ended up here, stupid, and that's right. No, no, let's keep going. This angle is the same as this one. It's the same as this. We move, take this triangle, we move it back, we get this triangle. So this triangle is the same as that. So we're moving along. We have this one, this one, this one, this one, I think, and this one. And we can get them all, for example, if we want to see that this one, this triangle is the same as this. We just observe that this, that we can take this, and we just move it around using this symmetry or the of the pentagon, and then it will just fall in here. So this angle is the same as that. So what is the upshot? The upshot is we have a lot of angles that are the same, but in particular, this triangle has the peculiar property that, first of all, it's isosceles, namely this side is equal to this side, it's two sides equal, and that means that this angle, which is the sum of this one and this one, is equal to the sum of that and that, so these two are equal, and these two are equal, so their sums are equal. And it's twice that. So that's a peculiar property of that triangle, namely it has one angle, which I call the triangle, one angle which I call theta, and then the other two are exactly double it, two theta. Follows from the symmetry, as I say, and this theorem that we have yet to prove, that no matter where we start on the circle, provided we fix the chord, we get the same angle when we join, take two lines. So just to tell you what that means, just so to speak in modern notation, means we have the sum of the angles of interior angles of a triangle is 180 degrees. We have theta and twice it in the one of the other vertices, and then twice theta again, 180. 5 theta is 180, and so theta is 36 degrees. So inside this pentagon is this triangle. One angle is 36, and two is 72. And what we have to do, and what Euclid does, is construct this triangle. And then we're done, basically, because we just run through the argument in reverse. We say, once we have this, and that's the problem, then we make this angle equal to that, so we build this, make it this angle equal to that, so we build that, we get this point, same way we get that point, and all we have to do, and it's easy enough to do, is just check that indeed all the sides are equal and all the angles are equal, that this full angle is equal to this full angle, this one, and all sides are equal. So that is the mysterious object, this triangle. And that's the object that we have to think about. I recall that, not quite in that form, but almost in that form, it was something that the Pythagoreans apparently did like, because what they used as their symbol, I recall, was this pentagram, or this five-pointed star. And this this pentagram really emphasizes that triangle. And the five similar triangles I get by just moving the vertex around. All right, so this I think will take a good deal of next time, because in order to prove this, in order to establish the existence of that triangle, we have to use material from all of the first four books, as I'll explain. But let's for now, let's see, another exercise, see if we can't convince ourselves of this fact, namely, that if we have a chord of a circle, and if we build two triangles like that, then this angle, no matter where we put the point, is equal to this angle, no matter where we put that point. Let's see if we, so this is something that many of you will, not all I suppose, but many of you will remember from high school. I think this is the kind of theorem that some proof or other found its way into North American high schools. So let's do it. It's a nice argument. And once we have that, once we have that out of the way, once we understand why this triangle has the properties it has, if it's related to the pentagon, to the regular pentagon in the way I described here, then we can go set about constructing this angle and see what this triangle, the one we've in bold lines, has to do with the square root of 5. All right. So these are my, this is the same figure over again. I've given just a, so the situation is clear. I've given this this angle a name, theta. And what we do and what is done in Euclid, this is, as I said, this is something, this is a proposition in the third book. We show that this angle is equal to double the angle at the center. So this is the center of the circle right here. We show this angle, double the angle at the center. We'll also show that this angle is double the angle at the center, and therefore they're the same. Now, you might ask yourself, well, why, I mean, this is any point on the circle, this is any point on the circle, why does it look so different? Why does this triangle look so different than this triangle? And you'll notice that there's a transitional point that as we move this around, for example, and there'll become a point where this line just passes through this line. And then the picture changes and the argument changes a little bit too. So let's see how we're going to do that. So we have two arguments. One for the first case and one for the second case. As I said, this is proposition 3.20, so a proposition from book 3. So we want to show, let's see if we can do it. We want to show that this angle is double this angle. And half, thank you. So let's do it twice. Let's just draw this line through the center, so AEF, which goes through the center. We want to show that the full angle here is one half, this full angle. So let's do it in two steps. Let's do it the part that's on this side of the line and the part that's on the other side of the line. So let's show, I think I have it written down here. If I'm not mistaken, that says that angle FEB is twice the angle EAB. So that's this angle, twice that. And then we just do the same thing on the other side and we're done. So we want to show this, and that's now relatively easy. What do we see? AE is a radius, EB is a radius. So AE and EB are equal lengths. And then we use something that Euclid has established long ago now, but that we haven't discussed, but I hope you remember, namely that that means that this triangle, AEB, is, well, it means it's an isosceles triangle, and it also means that this angle, BAE, is equal to the angle EBA. So I've indicated that they're equal. That's the first step. The second step is to use the fact that the sum of the three triangles, angles in the triangle, equal to two right angles. That's the second line here. So this angle, and this angle, I'll add up, try to remember that, two right angles, and also that this triangle and this triangle, this angle and this angle add up to two right angles. So FEB and AEB add up to two right angles. And then we're done. We just take the difference. We just throw away what's equal, and we're left with FEB from the bottom line, and we're left with EAB plus EBA from the middle line, but according to the top line, that's 2 EAB. So we end up with the fact that this angle is twice this. That kind of argument. Now, then, this the second case, the case where we've been so maladroit as to put the point over here, we want to show that this angle, CDB, is equal to twice BEC. Angle BEC is equal to DC. So that's the bottom conclusion here. All right. So what do we do? Well, all we do is we just apply the same theorem that we had up here, but to various chords. We apply it to this chord. With this chord, we'll have to apply it to this angle, GEC, and the smaller angle is the angle G. So the angle GEC is equal to twice the angle GEC. Applied to this chord, we do something similar with this chord. Same theorem as the general theorem, and we have the angle GE, the big one, and GDB is the small one, and it's half the big one. And then what we observe is that we just observe, so we have a statement about this angle and about this one. So we subtract the smaller one, so EDB, from the bigger one, EDC, and we're left with BDB. So one of these two, I forget which, taken away from the other, leaves BDC. And in the same way, do the same thing here. One of these two taken from the other leaves BEC. So from these two equations, this is equal to twice this, this is equal to twice this, we deduce that that's equal to twice that. So for example, BEC is equal to GEC minus GEB. So, but I wanted to go through that again. And now, let's have a minute or two. We have a minute or two. I'm just going to indicate, I don't want to do anything more today. I just want to indicate that we do have, unfortunately, to do a certain amount of work to construct our triangle, which is an isosceles triangle, having each of the angles at the base double of the remaining one. So this is a proposition from book 4. And we have to do it in three steps. This is one of them, which is where the square root of 5 comes in. I'll repeat this next time. So something else where properties of circles are used, I think. And that should be about it. These two propositions in book 3, which are really propositions about circles and which are quite complicated. So that's our work, and I certainly think it will take us all up next time. So we're running over, so far, at least one lecture. My original plan at the very, very beginning, long, long ago, was to finish the construction of the triangle in two lectures, but I don't think I'm going to. I'm not going to. That's good. Anyhow, thank you again for your patience. It's